So Sapphire's Infinite Zoom is a fantastic way of creating interesting and intricate motion backgrounds. In this tutorial, we're going to be looking at the basic controls of Infinite Zoom. And then we're going to come in and see how we can adjust certain different parameters to create a number of interesting effects. And we're going to start with this squiggle animation, which actually is going to begin life here as a simple rectangle. Now I'm working in After Effects because some of the projects have quite a lot of layers, but the way that Infinite Zoom works across all the different hosts is essentially the same. So whether you're working in After Effects, Premiere, Avid, Resolve, or any of the other Sapphire hosts, you're going to be using the same types of parameters. But let's start with our square. And I'm going to come in and I'm going to go to Sapphire Distort, Infinite Zoom. And we now get our basic Infinite Zoom. And I can travel through this box by keyframing up the zoom, and I can add a bit of rotation in it by obviously using the rotation controls. And just so we have something that's a bit more interesting to look at when we go through and change up our parameters, I am going to come in and set my zoom and my rotate to auto animate using expressions. So I'm just going to alt click on my zoom. And when I alt click on my zoom control, it's going to allow me to type an expression down in the timeline. And I'm just going to base this off of time because I just want this moving forward at a constant speed depending on where we are in the timeline. So I'm just going to go time plus one because I want the minimum value to be one. So now if I bring this in, we've just got a slow, steady move through our infinite zoom. And I'm going to do the same sort of thing with the rotate as well. I'm just going to come in and I'm going to go time. We're going to want this a bit faster. So I'm going to go time times 25. So we've just got a very straightforward move through our infinite zoom tunnel. So let's add a bit of interest now to our zoom. Now basically anything that happens to our layer is going to affect how the zoom looks. So if I scale this up or down, you know, we could get a bit of scaling within our source material. In this case, it's not going to make a big difference simply because we've already animated up the zoom. So the scale is always going to be down from the bottom to the top. So let's make a few other changes just to our basic shape. I'm going to come in and I'm going to round my corners out. So I'm going to come into the shape itself, just add a bit of roundness to my corners. And I can make this a complete swirl if I want to, which could be kind of interesting actually. I'm going to add a bit more interest to it as well by adding in a repeater in here. This is again to the shape layer. Just open up this and instead of moving it, actually that is kind of interesting, but instead of moving it just in the position there, which what I've got there, I'm going to come in and maybe just change the scale and rotation up a little bit. So let's scale it down to what, 94% and change the rotation up just to add a slightly different pattern. And that's looking kind of nice. Now, so at this point, I can come back into the infinite zoom controls and I can start to maybe play around with these and sort of tweak these up a little bit. So I can change things up like shrink per level. So this has the effect of making the twists either further apart from each other or closer together. If I move shrink per level closer to one, they get very, very close together indeed. Obviously, I can't go all the way to one, otherwise it would just be the same image, but that's at 0.9. That's going to give me a really lovely moiré effect on a TV. So let's bring this down. I have this maybe around about 0.36. That's kind of maybe a little bit closer. We're a slightly tighter spiral, maybe about 0.443. So we get a nice sort of tighter spiral there. And I can, again, change how that spiral looks by changing up my twist amount. In this example, it's not going to make a huge amount of difference because we have a very, very simple shape that isn't sort of twisting too much. And so we've got our start to our hypnotic effect. So I'm kind of happy with where we are with the infinite zoom. One of the things I enjoy doing with this effect is actually adding animation or making some small changes to the source clip itself. Because we're working with a shape in After Effects, I can come in and I can add another parameter, which is my wiggle paths. And this will start to wiggle up. Let's make this a little bit bigger with a little less detail, maybe. This will start to wiggle up the paths that we have. I'll make that wiggling a second to make that nice and smooth. So we get a sort of almost hand-drawn animation effect. Then I could always turn these corners back again, maybe take the correlation down, and then come back up and add another round corners over the top. Maybe I'm wiggling a bit too much, so just bring that to 10 a second instead. So we can start to play around with that and get some interesting effects. I'm going to move quickly on to a slightly more complex shape. This is a still from a video. Let's make sure that this is actually on a freeze frame. And we are good. And I'm going to again apply infinite zoom to this. And this one I'll have going clockwise instead of counterclockwise. And I'll actually do the same sort of thing just to add some animation to this as well. So add an expression, make this go a bit faster. So I'll go times times two on the zoom. And I will come into my rotate. And we'll make it a bit easier to adjust it a little bit by just leaving the original value here and just going plus and going times multiplied by, we'll do 25 again. Actually, we'll do minus 25 to send it going in the opposite direction. Yeah, that's kind of fun. And because in my expression, I actually have the original, I can just easily adjust where I want my starting point to be and we'll still get the same sort of move. And that's kind of interesting. Now, if I move my twist back a little bit, you can see something interesting happening here. When we use infinite zoom on a video track, we can easily see the video frame. In this case, it's black going over the top of the white there. So what I actually want to do is create a bit of transparency around here so it's not using all of the video frames. So we actually kind of get a softer transition between each of the copies of the video we get. And this is where I use my mask from path. So I'm going to come in, I'm going to use my ellipse tool with my layer selected to actually just create up a simple, straightforward After Effects mask. I can set this to none, and I can choose my mask from path over here as well, and that gives me a similar sort of effect. And I can feather this up as well, so we get a little bit more of a smoother transition. Let's twist this over again. And we've now got this sort of hypnotic effect where we've got the edges a bit more blended in together as well. Now, built into all of the Sapphire effects, we do have Mocha as well. So if I came in and did a similar sort of thing and drew a mask shape here in Mocha, we can actually use the Mocha shape to drive the shape with inside Infinite Zoom. So if you're working in a host that doesn't have native vector masks, you can always come in and use Mocha to create up your shapes instead, which I think is rather cool. All right, let's leave this mask nightmare and get to our next clip. And this clip just starts life actually as a black solid that I've then come in and added a texture chroma spiral to it, auto-animating using the same time expressions we've used several times before. I've then used the extract filter just to create a quick luma key on top of it so we can see that that's where we started and that's where we're ending in terms of transparency, and added a polar warp and a couple of wipe clocks just to smooth out some of the transitions between those two and just take away some of the areas there. So now we've got this strange abstract animation. And I've not really done too much with this from the default values that we saw previously. All I've done is keyframe the rotation and the zoom, as we've done before. I added a little bit of twist in there and changed the shrink levels. So we have slightly more distance between the different strands, between the different repetitions. Then just add a vignette and a glow, and we end up with something that's a lot more interesting very, very quickly. And in this case, it really is the glow that adds in something a bit more special. Remember, any time we can come back in here, and if we wanted to make this a little bit more organic as well, maybe come into something like the distort category, maybe doing something like a wave set to a very low amount, and we'll take a look at how that affects it. And you see the small change in the bass shape can have quite a considerable effect on the end result. I'm liking that. If we take a look at our next example, this is actually one of the first ones we saw at the beginning of the video. And again, we're getting something quite complex out of a starting point that's simple and straightforward. I've just got the Sapphire laser beam effect bouncing back and forward between these two points. Nothing too special, but when we start combining effects together, it gets a little bit more exciting. Again, I've used one of my favorites, the kaleidoscope polar effect, adjusting up the Z distance just a little bit, and then feeding that into the infinite zoom afterwards to get me a nice spiral animating through. And because we've got the build-up of both the animation of the laser beams coming in plus the animation of that kaleidoscope effect, we get this much more complicated movement coming through our twists and our twirls. And who doesn't like a little bit of glow on that? And to learn the recipe of this glow, just go and take a look at my other tutorial, Building a Bigger, Beautiful Glow with Builder. And once I'm happy with that, we'll stick it on a colourful background, which is just the Sapphire Cloud Smooth, and defocus it with the defocus prism. And we end up with our final effect, where the heart of it is just a simple laser beam and the infinite zoom. Now, our basic shapes don't even have to be that interesting. My basic shape here is actually just the letter H, which if I come into my character palette, I've just zoomed 530% in the horizontal. And if I add infinite zoom to this one, I've made a few changes to it. The first one is trying to get the shrink level really, really low. So I've taken this to about 0.11, just kind of really separate out the different zoom layers as much as I possibly can. I've also changed the spiral strands to 2 counterclockwise instead of just having one spiral strand there. The next thing I want to do to make this interesting is actually to use the wrap function. And we can use the wrap function to either tile or reflect to change what happens to our shape when it's outside of what we can actually see. In this case, when you've got such a simple pattern, reflecting or tiling looks really, really nice on it. And so now once we're here, the only thing we really need to do is actually animate it up. I'm just going to animate up the zoom center on this one. And I'm just moving the zoom center around. And because we've got the reflection turned on, we get this really exciting effect that looks like a flyover of something. We've created the depth using that shrink per level here. So if I change up my shrink per level, we can change up how we affect or how we see those different layers as we move across them. And this is a slightly more non-traditional use of the infinite zoom, and it's one that I really, really love. And because I like to add a little bit of texture and animation into my shape as well, I've actually got a texture layer, which is the texture weave, just animating again from left to right. I'm not doing anything too exciting with this. I'm just going to use this as a track mat, as a track luma mat, just to give us a little bit of texture within our shapes there. And this just helps to break up some of that uniformity as we see this animating through. If we move on to our final example, we have that same idea of creating some sort of animation within our source clip that we're then going to use when we come in to do the infinite zoom. So if I add infinite zoom to my text now, everything here is pretty much the same as we've seen previously. So we've got animation going on the zoom, we've got animation going on the rotation. The only thing that I've done that's slightly different here is I've used the Shift X to actually move this whole animation over a little bit. And the reason I've done that is because when I pause the infinite zoom by just stopping the animation of the zoom and the rotation, that I wanted this text to be in the right place. So that's why I've taken the Shift X and just moved that into the right space there. There's a simple case of colorizing it using Psycho Stripes, adding a bit of shape using the embossed glass, and blurring things up using the blur motion. And I use the blur motion here to simulate a bit of motion blur, making sure that my center XY comes from the same point as my zoom center. So what that is just my zoom center minus the shift gives me the center XY there. Nice and easy. And then because we're talking about something digital, I've added a bit of digital damage to the text. Now, if we take a look at the background, let's find a bit of the background there. The background is actually the same idea. I've just copied and pasted the exact same things. Infinite zoom, psycho stripes to colorize, and blur motion to add motion blur from my text to the background. The background itself, if we have a little look at this, is just a very, very basic set of stripes, which is actually just texture cells with a wipe over the top of it. Wipe dots over the top to give me that. Adding in the infinite zoom onto that, adding in the background over the top, adding in my favorite big, beautiful glow. Again, link in the description about where you can find that one. And we end up with another result that is different to what we've seen previously with the infinite zoom. One of the things that I really like about infinite zoom is that even though there's only a limited number of parameters to change, just making small changes to a few of them can actually create completely different end results. And I hope this has inspired you to pick up infinite zoom and start to play around a little bit. If you've created something cool with Infinite Zoom, don't forget to link it in the comments below. If you have any questions about Infinite Zoom or any of the other techniques I've shown in this video, then ask them down below as well. I do read them all. If you learned something or found this style of video interesting, hit the like button below as well. It really, really helps out. And remember, you can grab a free trial of Infinite Zoom and all the other Sapphire effects by going to borisfx.com.